show today, we're talking about the dark side and the negative sides of beauty, because there is that as well. And I almost felt like, when talking about this subject to the producers, mm-hmm. is it gonna come off as whining, like, oh, I'm pretty, life is so hard.
Oh, poor pretty girl, let me get that first world problem.
But there are real things that are associated with beauty that mm-hmm. there is a negative to it.
There's the assumption that you're stupid.
Or whore.
Or definitely that you're a whore.
So all pretty girls are whores?
Yeah, it translates into promiscuity, especially voluptuousness, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. Right. And I'm just like, here's the thing, when you look like this, you can get away with saying no a lot. So right. why wouldn't I use that to my advantage? Right. It just makes certain people feel better to right. reduce you mm-hmm. to a prostitute or a whore, because they cannot conceptualize that you are physically blessed, that you have something going on upstairs, and that you figured out a way to use it to your advantage, and you didn't have to sleep your way to the top to do it. It's right. That's a very inconvenient truth for people.
Yeah, I honestly never felt any negative side of being pretty. I have learned how to, you know, use it to my advantage.
Her clapbacks are epic.
But this is the thing, and I think I've said this before. I don't think I never experienced anything negative, but some people have. But mm-hmm. I still can use that to my advantage, and I feel like, you know, who wants to book the video girl that doesn't sleep with the local rapper or the star athlete of the city? So I want people to believe that if you send me 5 bottles of rosé to the club while I'm hosting, I'm gonna sleep with you. Because then, guess what? My party is gonna be cracking. Promoter is happy, he made money. I made my money, I'm getting booked
again. So you
want
the rumors, you're okay with people thinking that, but it's not the reality.
Yeah, I'm totally okay with it. Jeez. I wish that, I think it start happening, people already find out that I don't get down like that, and now they don't want to book me. And I'm like, haven't you heard that I am a whore? Hello? I sleep with people.
That is such a healthy, I wish I would have had that
attitude. I wish I had it. She is so good at dangling the carrot.
She is. So one time we went to you went on the Vegas trip.
No,
this one.
No.
So one time I got a call from our friend saying, yeah. "Do you want to go to Vegas?"
No, we have to say who the friend is.
What we do?
Come on.
Okay.
Okay, hold on. Vegas, private plane, rich. Okay. Who do you think it is?
Okay.
There you go.
So I get the call that do you want to go? And he liked you. So me and my friend were the plus twos. We were just the plus twos. But because of that, I get the residual benefit of that, because we went shopping. I'd have to give no ass. And
No one did. Can we just agree that he treats like the girl that he likes and the girl that he doesn't like equally amazing? It's you want him to not like you either, too, because you're still going to like...
He's a very generous man.
He's a very generous.
And he's going to treat you like with so much respect regardless.
He is... he likes pretty things to wear pretty things.
Yes.
You know, he likes to see the pretty things that he buys on the pretty things that he's invited to be in his company. Right. And so it usually translates into many, many shopping bags, private jets, diamond Rolexes.
Right.
Diamond crosses.
Yeah.
It translates into a lot of stuff, you know, if you enter into that world.
So when people see these type of things, because, like, you know, a lot of stuff gets on Instagram, what are the negatives of that?
The assumption is that you screwed for it. Mm. The assumption is that you slept with somebody for it. And it's very rarely the truth. Depending on who it is, that I will say.
Right.
You know?
Yeah, and for some people, it's a reality. And I think that because we were exposed to, like, some of these things for so long, and we didn't have to do anything, and then some girls of this, you know, generation, because mm-hmm. we're kind of, like, not a part of this, mm-hmm. but, like, now the girls of this generation wanted that, but...
Meaning we were the older video, we've aged out, right? There's a new crop of newer, younger video models now,
Well,
right?
There's no videos. There's no such thing.
I mean, it's Instagram. Is there music videos? Right,
But they are getting paid nothing, so... Mm-hmm. You know, so, and they're not, like, nothing is happening from that either.
Their money now, you know, the money that we made from the big budgets or whatever the case is now made by Instagram posts, flat tummy right. tea, that sort of thing. You know, right. like Instagram sponsored posting, and they make a lucrative. You know, if yeah. they're good and they're business minded and savvy about it, they can make a very very good living off of that. But it's just it's a completely different era than when yeah. we all of kind course. Of. You know, came up.
So yeah. let's. I want to take you guys back to when we all were doing music videos, mid '90s, late '90s, early 2000s for mm-hmm. me. Rosa, you got in the game a little later than that.
I was the last one.
You the last.
2009 is when I started.
So mm-hmm. we've heard stories about women being sexually harassed on set. Like you hear these and during photo shoots for men's magazines. Let's talk about that. Mm-hmm. Have either of you had experiences with that being harassed, or we felt like you were in danger on set? I remember being on a video for a rapper, Second to None, mm-hmm. and it was a 2-day shoot.
Is that his name?
Yeah, I don't know.
I'm sorry.
West Coast rapper. So the second day, all the girls were quarantined in one room because one of the girls went and had a gangbang with some of the guys. I'm not saying it was him.
Wow.
But like maybe entourage guys, thinking that would help her advance and like get more visibility,
camera time.
They were doing that.
A gangbang for camera time?
Girl, bye.
No. I'm sorry.
But it made me, at an early in my career, be very nervous about things. Like, it just felt like, wow, I'm coming from Rhode Island, mm-hmm. and the thought that, you know, I'm here, I'm getting booked through a casting agent, mm-hmm. a legitimate audition, mm-hmm. really going about it like as a professional. Mm-hmm. So have y'all had any wild experiences on sets where you were nervous? I know, Melissa, you were talking about something earlier.
The reality of the situation is that you were a pageant queen, you know what I'm saying? So people started to get to know you in that legitimized world, mm-hmm. you know? And when I came into the video modeling world, it was just becoming that era where they were mini motion pictures, where the budgets were super inflated, like Jadakiss Knock Yourself Out was $650,000. Big Pimpin' was $1 million.
Just to give you guys some context, now videos are being shot for $200,000, maybe $100,000, maybe $75,000.
$50,000 the whole budget if they're lucky.
Yeah. So, you know, I have a friend that does videos, he directs videos, and he makes, he says that the budget is about $20,000
yeah.
or $25,000.
They used to legitimate, like every week.
And that's what you used to get paid.
Yeah. So the reality is that the scope of things changed. The landscape changed when Napster and piracy happened and all the illegal downloading. Mm-hmm. So now you take for granted that you stream Apple Music, et cetera, et cetera. There's a point in which that was illegal, and the big, massive record companies had lost control of their product.
Right.
And so music was illegally being downloaded, and so the record labels were like hemorrhaging money.
So that trickled down to the video.
So it trickled down into what, like, okay, so how do we start to save money? Video music budgets started to be just, the budgets were slashed by not just by half, into like an eighth
Nothing.
Of what they were.
Yeah.
And so you go from, you know, participating on like, you know, a $10 million yacht with Jay-Z and Damon Dash and stay away from me with that motherfucking bottle, you know, champagne, you know, and you're making $5,000 a day to, they literally go into a strip club and be like, hey, who wants to be in a video? And every stripper raises their hand. They're like, we got $100 for each of you. And they got 20 girls. So where do we fit in?
So that changed the vibes of the videos and made it less professional. So tell us about a time where you felt uncomfortable on a video, where maybe you felt like you were in danger or sexual harassment.
So because I was always chosen by the director, there was no casting process for me. I was literally just like, Melissa, are you going to be the lead mm-hmm. or the principal in this video? And that was how it was. I was casted for 3 weeks after I did Big Pimpin', I was casted for Cher Shayla Ghost with Ghostface Killer, who I love that song. Tommy Mottola.
Oh, I love that song.
The song is so fantastic.
That song's hot.
So they wanted to recreate this movie called Bachelor Party, and so they rented out 2 floors of the Parker Meridian Hotel in New York City, and they wanted to just have this scene that looked like just wild chaos, you know, hundreds of girls. There was probably about 60 girls booked for this. And just girls running in and out of hotel rooms and just debauchery. They wanted to allude to this. So at one point, I'm sitting in the craft services room, which is basically where all the snacks are, you know.
And of course you were there.
Of course I was in the snacks room, you know, and I'm wearing this tiny little dress, something like this, minus the tights, you know, because I was 22, 23 at the time when, you know, I didn't need these to suck it all in.
Oh, come on.
But I'm sitting there, and one guy comes in, you know, Entourage, because it was Wu-Tang, so the Entourage was crazy.
How many people are in Wu-Tang?
100,000.
Okay. They have so many affiliates
now. There's so many affiliates. So this is back in, like, 2000. And so one guy comes into the room. He goes, oh, hey, Miss Ford. Hey, how you doing? So I continue to sit there, and I'm, like, reading a book or something. And the craft services are random, but I don't know. And so long story short, Another guy comes in the room. By the time I look up, there's about six or seven guys in the room, and then one of them kind of turns to me, and he was like, Miss Ford, you look really, really beautiful. Yeah, you look hot. You look hot. And then they started to physically come over to me and started to kind of surround me. And then they started to touch me. Started to touch my leg, and they started to touch my arm and touch my face. Without asking me. And at this point in my age, I just didn't know how to, like, stand up for myself.
That happens to a lot of women that are trying to be in this business.
They're trying to be nice. Well, because of the fear of offending.
And let me just say this. It's not just, and I want people that are not in this business to also relate to this conversation. Mm-hmm. It's not just people in the business.
Yeah, right.
I think our parents do us a disservice when they teach us to be nice, be polite, and not offend. We don't embarrass people. We, like, will take that L sometimes.
Yeah.
So they'll feel comfortable.
Yeah.
So they're touching you and surrounding you, mm-hmm. a swarm of men around you from
the Wu-Tang. A swarm of men basically around me, and I'm terrified to yell and make a scene because I'm questioning if what's happening is really actually happening.
Right. Right.
And so, well, you know, a camera guy or a grip or whatnot, he walks into the room to, you know, get some dip and some celery sticks or whatnot. He's like, oh, hey, Melissa. And then I said, hey, and I had this look of panic on my face, and thank God he read that. And he was like, I think they need you on set.
Wow.
Let me walk you back to set. And I don't know what would have happened, but the touching was so uncomfortable, and I didn't know how to stand up for myself. I wanted to be a good girl. I wanted to be asked back. Mm-hmm. I wanted to continue to make this money, you know, because it was helping me pay for my way through university. So I didn't want to, like, make waves. And yeah. I was visibly terrified, and to this day, it still resonates with me. I wish that I could go back in time to tell
you're
that
younger
girl.
Then. You're not as confident as you are now.
Yeah. I got pretty lucky with that. I never had any, mm-hmm. I don't really have, like, any bad experiences.
So
really.
You were good.
You're a badass, that's why.
They were afraid because they knew I could just crack their skulls.
Especially with those thighs. So we have an audience question. What's your name?
Hi, my name is Marcus.
What's your question or comment?
My question for all three of you is, you talk about being on set for these different music videos. What was your most fun music video you've ever shot and or the most wild music video you've ever shot?
Rosa, what was yours? Best experience or wild experience?
it's only wild. Like, for example, if I'm doing, like, when I have done, like, a kissing scene or, like, like, you're making, like, love kind of, like, type of thing, that's wild from the moment they say action to cut. It's just, like,
you go for it.
Yeah.
Weren't you in a Trey Songz video and he was, like, picking you up and all kind of stuff?
Yeah, we didn't kiss, but we got, like, really, really close. And I felt comfortable because I've been knowing him I've been knowing him before I was modeling.
Okay.
Yeah, and so, you know, it was great. But I think the most, they are not quiet, like, for me at least, they weren't, like, fun while they were happening because it's, like, action, and then they just keep saying, happy, dance, this, that. So it's not, like, all natural, you know, but it's fun to watch it when it's, like, done.
Yeah.
And then you see it and you're like, wow, it looks amazing.
But while you're doing it, it's awkward.
Yeah.
Yeah, when it's happening, it's just...
It's weird.
Yeah, it's not really, like, when it's a club scene, you're not really at the club. They keep...
It's a room.
Yeah, they stop, they... action, cut, now one more time, smile again.
It's nowhere near as fun as it looks in the video.
Yeah, but it's fun to see it looking
later.
So good. Yeah.
Yeah.
Melissa?
I would definitely have to say Big Pimpin' is the first one that comes to mind.
That's a huge video.
I mean, the video, the song is so epic. The video is so epic. You know, the minute to this day, 20 years later, you play that in a club, people lose their minds.
Yeah.
It's part of the soundtrack of so many people's lives.
Facts.
And when we were on this yacht, like, God, the travel was arduous to get from Toronto to Trinidad. But literally, at 11 o'clock in the morning, I'm standing next to this other model, a beautiful chocolate girl named Hazel, from Toronto as well. And we're standing there in these bikinis, fully made up, 11 o'clock in the morning with glasses of crystal on the top deck of a $10 million yacht. And I said, can you believe that this is our life, girl? And she was just like, for 3 days it is.
Hell yeah.
Clink, it was so much fun. Even when the video itself, the cameras were rolling, we were getting so hammered off that crystal. It was great.
Any job you can drink on is a win, okay?
It was great. I would say, craziest, I would definitely say is Cher Shayla Ghost, just because it was so much madness and so many people and craziness. I would say that was the most chaotic one that I'd done.
I did, my first lead was with Ginuwine. It was a song called Only When You're Lonely, really beautiful song. Mm-hmm. And on set, one of the extras was in the front row. She took her bra off and threw it at him. That was not in the script. And they had to shut down everything, production, because one of the execs was there and she had a young daughter on set because she didn't think it was a sexual scene in the video. Mm. We had no sexual scenes with us. It was just like, it was a storyline. Back then, videos had storylines.
Yeah.
So. Everything got shut down because the vibe just changed and became something it wasn't supposed to. Mm-hmm. And they kicked her out the set. Mm. So I remember talking to her before they kicked her out. I said, why did you do... I said, first of all, how much are you getting paid?
Yeah.
She said, $50. I said, why did you do that? She goes, I don't know. I just think that it could lead to something. And basically, she was at the school of thought that any publicity is good publicity. And it was going to resonate with the director. And he's going to bring her back. I'm like, no, well, you're a girl. That's your top.
These days, that will work.
That will work
just
now.
Just tell her to try it again.
You're so quick.
20 years later, girl, try it.
She was ahead of her time.
Now, she was ahead of her time.
Melissa, during the interview you talked with CNN, you talked about how you felt you helped perpetuate the negative stereotypes of black women because of your work. In some of those videos, do you feel that way still?
You know, a lot of people, this is what happened. So I did the music videos, I'm putting myself through university. I don't think that I'm doing anything. I'm also appearing in men's magazines and that sort of thing. And then I started to get requests, you know, as the years went, I started to get requests to do panels, you know, and a lot. And during the year of like 2004 to 2008, there seemed to be like so many panels, hip hop and feminism, you know, like you were on a couple of them. Mm-hmm. This is what the first three rows of the audience looked like. Black women with their arms crossed, looking at me like I was responsible for racial genocide. Mm-hmm. And it started to weigh on my conscience, like, you know, I'm just a girl from Canada, and I look pretty cute. I'm able to be casted in music videos. I'm paying my own way through university. This is, you know, tax-free American money. I get to go on some trips and, you know what I'm saying, and entertain my friends back home. Like, I didn't see anything wrong with that. And at the time, I think that when I participated in that interview, I had been shamed so much, and I had been made to feel so guilty for my participation in music videos and men's magazines and that sort of thing. I don't think that way about myself at all. I don't agree with what I said back then at all. I think that I was just speaking a narrative of what was expected, and I wanted people to like me, and now I don't give a shit.
What changed? What made you change?
Thanks, guys. I got older, and I got older, and I started to realize that I'm a good person. Mm-hmm. You know, that I'm a compassionate human being. I'm a contributing member of society, and it's not like I was posing nude, which I don't think there's anything wrong with that. It's not like I was doing porn, and for a lot of people, that's a way that they've made a living. I don't judge, but I wasn't doing what I was being accused of, and other people needed to restructure the way they thought. It had nothing to do with me. I just really absorbed people's projection of their own insecurity and their own sense of negativity. I absorbed it. I took it on because I could not stand up for myself. I didn't start standing up for myself maybe until a couple of years ago.
Right.
I've always been such a people pleaser. And that is why I said those remarks, because I was on CNN with Soledad O'Brien. Mm-hmm. You know, I felt like I was supposed to say these things. And I do not agree with anything that I said at that point at all.
Rosa, what about with you? It seems like you've had more pleasant experiences with your beauty and with, you know, being in music videos. Was there ever a time you felt shame? I saw you on blogs a couple times. Did they link you to a few celebrities?
Yeah, I wish they did it more often because it brings me so much more money. Let me tell you, I used to deny these things so hard. Oh, you're dating such and such, and the first one. No, I'm not. And now I'm like hoping that they say, I see a celebrity and now I'm like, take a picture. I just touch his shoulder. Because these days, it can bring so much money, even if it's not truth. Like, my fantasy is that I go to Whole Foods and that Brad Pitt is getting out, and I'm going to walk so fast right after him so they think that we're together, that we're living together, doing groceries. Because I have learned how to monetize from all the...
Yeah, you have.
Rosa is
about her money.
I'm a poor little Dominican girl.
That was what I was about to say, that I'm a poor Dominican girl. I came here with $20 and a chicken under my arm. So, yes, I need this money, you guys. So whoever you think I'm dating, I am. Please. Yes.